She's currently a part of the core team supporting the work of the Government of India's Empowered Group 1 for managing the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you so much for being here, ma'am. So we will be beginning with this session now. The session will be divided into two parts. One is the main lecture by ma'am, which will go on for 35 minutes, and then we will have a Q&A session for 25 minutes. Ma'am, you can start. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much. And, very nice to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me. And I hope, everyone's doing well. And, obviously, we're going through very difficult times. But I think there's a lot of opportunities and lessons for us from this as well. So I'll try and talk about that also, rather than just focusing on all the grim sort of news that we've had over the last few months, obviously. So I'll just start very quickly, about the pandemic management per se in the country, just give you a sort of broad overview of what all has happened in the last few months, because a lot has happened, in just these last few months. So this virus, as some of you might know, but for the benefit of everyone, it's a very new virus. It is something the world has not seen before. And, it's also quite peculiar in a sense that it's not like some of the other viruses where you get symptoms immediately. So you get fever or you get, some other obvious symptoms. So you can actually isolate yourself. In this particular case, you often don't get any symptoms at all, which is what makes it very difficult to sometimes identify that, who is the person who is actually unwell and can spread the virus to others. So that is what makes this virus quite tricky in how it behaves. And it behaves very differently in everybody. Somebody gets very severe symptoms, somebody has no symptoms at all, as I said. So there is no predictable pattern. Yes, there are some high-risk populations. So generally, the elderly are considered to be high risk. People who have other conditions like diabetes, heart disease, they're considered to be high risk. So we do have some of these sort of risk factors, but frankly, it behaves very unpredictably. It's very difficult to say who might be at risk or, who might have a severe form of the disease. So it is something that we all have to be very, very cautious about. So the government, we first had our first confirmed case in India around the 30th of January, which was in Kerala. And after that, in March, of course, as all of you know, we had the lockdown, which was imposed. And of course, there are a lot of questions around the lockdown, whether we needed a lockdown, whether we should have had it at a different timing, etc. Now, the question is that why we needed lockdown. Lockdown is never a solution to any sort of crisis. But what a lockdown does is it allows you to press the pause button. If you sort of are aware of the health system in the country, it is fairly underdeveloped in many, many states, in many districts. And it's very variable. In some district states, we might be able to have a, decent health system response. But in large parts of the country, we don't even have the basic, health personnel, the doctors, the nurses, the facilities. So we had to press this pause button in order to allow the health system to gear up. And by gearing up, I mean we had to produce ventilators, we had to produce masks, we had to produce personal protective equipment. We had to train our doctors and nurses. They had never seen a virus like this. So they did not know. They did not know that how do we, deal with something like this. So we had to do all that training, capacity building. We had to put in place the protocols, for handling this public health crisis, because it's a very diverse country. As you know, it's a federal structure. Most of the decisions, actually, the key decisions when it comes to public health care are actually taken at the state level. And usually not at the central level. The center does have an important role to play, but the actual implementation and decision making is really down to the states in a country like India. So it makes it very complex. And so we had to do this lockdown to sort of press this pause button. But of course, in a country like India, we are a very poor country still. We have a large informal economy. We have a lot of migrant workers. So definitely there were a lot of hardships that resulted from a lockdown like this. And you know, there is definitely a case that the lockdown could perhaps have been implemented administratively, managed better, especially for the in terms of the migrant workers, where we did have a lot of issues. So I think that aspect is very much something that has been a challenge. But from a purely public health perspective, we had to press this pause button, because without that, we would have been like, you know, you go to war to fight an enemy and you have no weapons, you have nothing, you're not trained. So it would have really, really been very difficult if we were left in that situation. The other important thing to remember is that our population is not used to practicing public health and hygiene behaviors. I come from a public health background, and it shocks me that we need a pandemic to teach us hand washing. You know, hand washing is always important. You know, hand washing, COVID or no COVID, your hands are the primary source of infection for most diseases, actually. So hand washing, maintaining hygiene in public places is something that we should always follow. But unfortunately, it is not something that is inherent in our culture and in our behavior. So we had to spend time to, you know, try and get people to start wearing masks, to start, you know, following hand hygiene, to practice as much distancing as possible. You know, in a country like India, sometimes I say that physical distancing is a luxury. You know, because we are a very poor country, you know, think of all the people living in slums, and if you're telling them to do physical distancing, it's not very practical. So yes, of course, it's not always possible in a country like India, but to the extent possible, we did have to try and inculcate this culture, you know, of keeping a distance from other people. So if you compare us with the Southeast Asian countries, they're very used to these things. So you don't need separate time to do this, right? Or masks, for instance, if you look at Japan, you know, wearing masks is very common. You know, wearing masks in public transport, in places of gatherings, is a very common cultural habit. But that is not the case in India. So we had to inculcate all of that. We couldn't just let people to sort of their own devices when we were faced with a very unknown sort of a crisis situation. So that is why we had to do the lockdown. But progressively, of course, the lockdown decisions have been decentralized. Now it is really up to states and even districts and cities to decide. And the recommendation from the center is that let's not do any more large-scale lockdowns, because we don't want to disrupt livelihoods. We don't want to further disrupt the economy, especially for the poor people. So if we have to do a lockdown, let it be very micro level. You know, let it be at a very small level. But let's not do any large-scale lockdowns anymore. Because as I said, a lockdown doesn't take the disease away. All it does is it gives you a little bit of time to prepare your health system. So that is really something that happened on the lockdown side. Now, on the Government of India response itself, the government set up these empowered groups of officials. I have been working directly with one of those empowered groups, which was responsible for preparing the medical emergency management plan for the country, which basically means that we were doing forecasts. You know, how many cases do we expect in a particular state, in a particular district? And based on that, what sort of infrastructure requirements do we think we need? What sort of ventilators do we need? How much oxygen, you know, availability do we need to ensure? So all of that. Now, if you look at COVID itself, about 80% of people are either asymptomatic or they have very mild symptoms. So, you know, those people can actually stay at home. Or they can be looked after in a COVID care center, because again, home isolation is not possible for everyone in India. You know, we are a very highly populated country. Sometimes you have 5, 7, 10 people living in one congested room. So where are you going to do home isolation? So for some people, for such people, we have designed these COVID care centers, which are basically just isolation centers. They don't need to provide any specific healthcare, medical care over there, because these are people who have no symptoms. Then is the second level of people, which is about 15% of the cases, who actually have some mild to moderate symptoms. And these are people who might even need oxygen support. So for such people, the dedicated COVID health centers have been set up. And here you do have oxygen support, you have a doctor, you have nurses. And the third level are the just about 5%. Actually, what we are fortunate in COVID is that the very serious cases are a much smaller proportion in a sense. So it's only about 5% of the cases which do become quite serious. and 4% of this of these people need ventilation, which is non-invasive. So they need non-invasive ventilation, and 1% require invasive ventilation. So based on these sort of rough kind of percentages, we have been doing infrastructure projections for all the states, the districts. Also now we have been factoring in, you know, things like the festival season is coming up, so we might see a surge in cases. The winter months are coming up. In some cities like Delhi, the air quality is starting to go down. So we might see other conditions like bronchitis. We might see influenza, which you normally see in the winter months. And all of this could get combined with COVID. So we are preparing for an additional sort of rise in cases at this particular point in time. And we're doing our projections accordingly. And of course, a lot of efforts are also going on the behavior. As I said, because initially people started off, they were very afraid of the virus. Over time, now people have sort of learned to live with the virus, which is good. But it also doesn't mean that we should let down our guard, you know, because in Europe, you can see that the situation is getting very bad again. The winter is back and the cases are really rising like anything. In the US, again, there is a large spike in cases. So we are not out of it yet. And so it is important to send that message to people that, yes, you must live your life. Yes, you must get on with your life. But it cannot be at the cost of your sort of health and hygiene behaviors. You have to still follow those. So I think that is kind of the focus at this point in time. There is also a lot of effort being put into the vaccine. The vaccine, right now, the trials are underway. And, you know, a lot of candidates are looking promising. There are some candidates which have moved forward to advanced stages of those clinical trials. And we are in parallel working on a supply and distribution plan for the vaccine. Because, you know, once the vaccine becomes available, we need to first get it out to the most high-risk groups. So we are developing a prioritization framework, which is based on the WHO, the World Health Organization prioritization framework, which is to say that you will first give the vaccine to your health workers, to the elderly, to people who have comorbid conditions like diabetes, cancer, heart disease, etc. And then in stages, you will get it out to the whole population. Of course, it's a big challenge. We have a huge population to reach with something like this. Most of our vaccination system so far has been geared up towards maternal and child health. Now we are talking about vaccinating the entire population. So it's going to be a big challenge. But that is why we've started to sort of prepare for it from now. But we have to let the science first do its role, you know, because you cannot fast track the science. If you fast track the science, you can end up with a vaccine which is not safe, which might not be as effective, and then you can end up doing more damage than good. So we have to really be very careful that the vaccine goes through the full clinical trial procedure, and only then it actually comes out into the population. So that is something which is happening in parallel at this time, and this is of course a big sort of piece of the work that is happening. We are also looking at vaccine candidates abroad. In case some vaccine candidate comes out overseas, how do we quickly get it to India? How do we quickly manufacture it here, distribute it to people here? So all of that is also going on. And what we have actually learned in this process is that, you know, working with the states is very, very important. That center-state coordination has to be there. It is very difficult in a country like India because, you know, we are a federal structure. There are different governments. There's politics. There's all sorts of things. So everything comes into the equation. But whatever it is, in a country like India, we do have to work. The center, the state, even the sub-state levels, you know, the districts, the cities. We do have to work together, and in this case, there have been some good examples. In fact, we are also trying to document some of the practices that have come out. We are trying to make a compendium of practices which have been followed by different states and districts in trying to contain this epidemic. And so that is something which is coming out now. But I think the biggest lesson from this, from a health system sort of perspective, is investing in public health, and I think that is really what I would like to stress on, that we are a very cure focused, we are a very hospital based health system. We think about our health when we fall ill, that's when we think about health, you know, but that is not health at all. You know, health is not merely the absence of disease. The health is actually your overall well-being. It's your mental, physical, social, overall well-being, you know. So it's not that, okay, I don't have a disease, I'm fine, I'm healthy. That's not what health really is. Health is about prevention. It is about promotion. And we need to reorient our health system completely. We need to move away from simply building hospitals. Of course, you need hospitals. Of course, you need doctors. Of course, you need specialists. But you also need public health people. You know, you need nurse practitioners. If you look at countries like UK, you look at Thailand, they have a huge cadre of what we call nurse practitioners. So these are people who will actually be your first sort of interface with the health system. You don't straight away meet a doctor because for everything, you don't need a doctor. You know, there are many milder conditions, lesser conditions, which actually other health personnel can treat perfectly well. And also what we need to do in a country like ours, which again, you don't need a doctor for, is large-scale screening, large-scale awareness. That's what we need to do. So all of these are public health functions. These are not clinical or medical functions per se. So we need to invest in public health at you know, NITI Aayog, and through my other work, I have really been trying to work on this and emphasize this. We are trying to develop a public health cadre in states also now, and a lot of states have come on board to say that we will invest in developing this public health cadre. Because, you know, public health is a very multidisciplinary field, you know, as opposed to medicine, which is very focused and, you know, it's usually focused on cure and treatment. Public health is mostly about prevention and health promotion. And it's interdisciplinary. In public health, you need epidemiologists, you need health economists, you need social scientists who can understand, you know, how human beings behave. Right. So you need all these functions in public health, and you don't find all of this in a doctor. A doctor has a very particular expertise, and that's what they do. So we need to supplement all of this in our system in a big way. You cannot become pandemic ready in 4 months, 5 months, 6 months. You need to invest in public health over decades. If we look at China, that is what China has done. Right. I mean, with China, there's always a question mark. You know, are their numbers right? Are they telling the truth? Which is fine, which is absolutely fine. But no one can take away from the fact that they have a very strong public health system, which they have invested in after SARS. So in around 2003-04, after the SARS outbreak in China, which completely ruined their economy, they realized that we have to invest in public health. And so they have made very, very strong and strategic investments. And it's really time for us to learn this. I hope that this will also be India's sort of SARS moment, in that sense that we will actually learn what China learned, and we will invest in our systems, in our people, in our human resource. If you look at the National Health Service in the UK, it's completely full of Indian nurses, you know, and here we are short of nurses, right? So why can't we keep our nurses here? Why can't we give them good career opportunities? Why can't we, you know, treat them well, give them the right incentives? Same with our ASHA workers, our Anganwadi workers, right? So I think that is the part we need to focus on, because, you know, you can build equipment, you can build hospitals, you can have ICUs, but if you don't have trained people to operate all of that, it really makes no sense. So I think that is something we need to do. And the second bit we need to invest is in changing people's behaviors. This is a very difficult task. It's a very long sort of term task. So, I mean, if we think about our own behaviors, it's not very easy to change our habits, right? We often get quite fixed in our habits after a while. So, you know, if somebody just comes along and says, hey, you know, you need to change this habit, we're like, you know, why should I'm just fine. So it's not easy to change human behavior. That's probably one of the most difficult things. But we need to invest in it. Now that we have gained some momentum due to this pandemic, at least some people now realize that, okay, I have to wash my hands, I have to wear masks, I have to be careful in a public place, in a crowded place. So now that we have got some momentum, we need to continue it. We need to build it. We cannot lose this momentum. So that is another very, very important piece that I think we need to continue going forward. And another one is how we think of our cities. Because, you know, if you realize that the pandemic has mostly been an urban phenomenon all over the world, it has mostly impacted cities. The rural areas have been much lesser affected. And that is because cities are very populated, they are densely, you know, crowded. So it is much easier for such infections to spread rapidly. It's not just COVID, it's tuberculosis as well. I've worked for several years in tuberculosis. And in tuberculosis also, you find that in urban slums, it spreads very rapidly. So we need to think about our cities also much more, how we design our cities, how we plan them. We need to think of urban, you know, transport, infrastructure, water sanitation. Water sanitation is still very poor in many parts of the cities, how we do waste management. And then gender. I think gender is another very, very important part. You know, we don't give enough attention to it. But in fact, in the pandemic, a lot of groups have suffered disproportionately. You know, people with disabilities, women, you know, a lot of these, you know, transgender people. So we really need to focus on all of this. You know, we need to really include them in all the discourse when we think of cities, how we plan for cities, how we plan our programs and all of that. So I hope that, you know, this pandemic will actually give a fillip to some of these very long-standing issues that we've had. And another one, and sort of the last one I'll highlight here, is technology. Technology use, it provides a huge opportunity. You know, now I find that even in the government, which is usually very reluctant to adopt technologies, I mean, I never even thought that we could do any online meetings in the government ever. We do still have to go into the office all the time, but I'm happy to see that at least we are, you know, getting more comfortable with technology use and you know, all of that. So I think that's another big area of opportunity for the government to work with the private sector, to work with, you know, NGOs, to work with academic institutions, to actually come up with some very strong technology solutions, not just in healthcare, but, you know, in education, in sanitation, so many sectors. The pandemic has just opened up a whole, you know, gamut of opportunities that technology can bring. But a word of caution on technology, that, you know, you must not forget the human side of technology. You know, the user of a technology is always a human being. The person who is the beneficiary of the technology is a human being. So yes, technologies are important, but they're not a substitute. They're a good supplement. They are something which is useful. But we should obviously not sort of just get carried away in itself and sort of forget all the other pieces. So that's always sort of an important word of caution on technologies, because, you know, they're very exciting and it's sort of easy to kind of get carried away with the latest new piece of technology and forget that, you know, there's several other elements to it. And I think in public health, I've seen it time and again, you know, people come in with a fantastic technology solution, but it just doesn't work, you know, because people are not comfortable, it's not culturally acceptable, so many other reasons, you know. So we just always have to be conscious of that. And that is why I feel that in public health, we actually need people from social sciences backgrounds, from other backgrounds, you know. You don't just need medical doctors, you need a lot of other disciplines in public health, because you have to understand human behaviors, and you have to understand how to design and implement programs at scale. So I think those, you know, are really, I would say, some of the major takeaways that come to my mind from this whole situation. And I think now, of course, we are entering into about 2-3 months where we have to be very, very cautious. We have to be very, very careful, because this is something which is here to stay for now. Even if we get a vaccine, it doesn't mean that it's going to be 100% solution and this is just going to go away. We'll still have to continue to follow, you know, some of these norms at least. And as I said, some of these norms we should always follow. You know, hand hygiene, being careful in crowded places, we should always follow these norms, because it's not just COVID, you know, so many other diseases spread through this. So I think these are the basics, and it's really time for us to go back to some of these basics and really emphasize these in the population, while of course using all the latest developments and technologies and everything that comes our way. So so I think I'll just sort of pause here. I think I've spoken a lot without any pause. I'll pause here and maybe we can now just, you know, take up questions and have more of a discussion. I think that might be better.
Okay, so we've already received a few questions via mail, but whoever has more questions, they can always put it in the chat box and we'll pick the questions from there. Now, the first question to you, ma'am, is what kind of negative ripple effects have the COVID crisis caused to the healthcare system at a macro level?
Yes, I mean, this is it's a good question. It's an important question because especially during the lockdown, but even after the lockdown, there was obviously a neglect in some places of other services, you know, and other essential services, whether it is immunization, whether it is screening for cancer, screening for TB. So definitely, you know, certain surgeries which are pending. Yes, of course, it's okay if some of the non-essential, non-urgent sort of interventions were postponed. That is fine because you don't want to expose people unnecessarily to hospitals at this time. But in some cases, you had certain essential services which have got disrupted, and that happened because obviously the entire health system started focusing on this. You know, we as I said, it was something so unknown for us. And given that it's still a fairly nascently developed, you know, health system in many parts of the country, we didn't really have the, you know, option to focus on everything at the same time. So yes, definitely that is a concern. Now, of course, we are trying to do our best to see that, you know, how can we sort of catch up on some of the sort of damage that might have been done due to neglect of other services. So I think that's definitely happening. But I think not just in India, but world over, this is a big question mark. You know, I think everybody is asking that, are we going to end up reversing the, you know, the health gains that we have made in other areas? Because that's the last thing you want to do. You know, it's taken so many years to make progress in some of these areas. So let's see. I think, you know, that is something which we will get to know in the times to come. But definitely there has been an impact in terms of the other essential services. But the other, as I said, the sort of positive impact has been that we have gained, you know, in terms of clinical management experience, we have gained in certain amounts of, you know, just training and capacity building for our health workers. So there have been gains as well, but it's important to sustain these gains. I feel that in India, we have very short memory. We have very short public memory. The system has a very short memory. So, you know, it's a burning issue today, but tomorrow we might forget it. So I hope that we don't do. You know, because that's really, it really gets frustrating. You know, somebody who's a public health person, for me, it's terribly frustrating when I see that, oh, we're having a pandemic, everyone's talking about public health, and suddenly after a few months, everybody will be quiet. And I will be like, well, you know, why has everyone stopped talking about public health? It's still just as important, you know. So I hope we will not do that. I think that is my biggest, and I think the onus of that lies on all of us. Of course, it lies on the government. Of course, there's just no taking away from that. But, you know, it also lies on each one of us to keep that pressure up, to keep asking our governments those questions. On the media, I think the media sometimes, you know, it's pandemic, everybody's talking about COVID, and then suddenly they'll go quiet. So you know, we must talk about this issue on a daily basis, because every single day, people are losing their lives to preventable diseases in our country. And, you know, this is something that someone like me who's very passionate about public health, it really bothers me. It really bothers me that if I have an issue, I can go to a hospital, I can see a doctor, I can get treated. And yet there are so many people in this country who are dying, you know, even from something as basic as diarrhea. There's still people dying of diarrhea. I mean, nobody should be dying of diarrhea, right? So it's, you know, we need to bring in that sort of passion into this, that we are going to always question you. If it's the government, if it's, you know, anybody, right? It's a people's representative, it's the media. We need to constantly keep up this discourse that, you know, public health is important, so that the lessons we've learned are not forgotten.
Another question is, and this we received this question multiple times, what are the required changes in health infrastructure needed to cater to the growing population?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I touched upon a lot of these, so I'll quickly sort of just summarize in you know, response to this. I think, as I said, you know, we need major reforms in our entire public health system, which would mean I already mentioned the public health cadre, so a dedicated cadre of people who can work on public health programs. B, a focal point, because you know what happens with public health precisely because it is so multidisciplinary. The health department doesn't talk to the nutrition guys don't talk to sanitation doesn't talk to environment, environment doesn't talk to agriculture, and I'm talking within the government system, right? Every ministry is separate, every department is separate, and nobody talks to each other, you know, in that sense. So we need a focal point. We need one agency, we need one focal point in the government, which can coordinate between all these bodies. Because public health, as I said, you need multiple actors to come together. You cannot have just the health guys working on it. You know, you need the nutrition people, you need the gender people to come in, right? Gender is a huge part of it. You need the sanitation people, the environment people. Look at air quality. You know, air quality has a direct impact on health. Agriculture. You can't have nutrition without agriculture, you know. So we are also trying to push for this sort of focal point, which can actually bring together all of these actors within the government system. Then we do need to do a lot of reforms in our education, medical education. A lot of you might have heard of the recent bills which have been passed. In the, you know, to replace the Medical Council of India, to replace some of the councils regulating education in Indian systems of medicine. Now, these were highly corrupt and highly inefficient councils. So these had to go. But I just hope that, you know, the ones which replace them will you know, go in the right way. So I think that is something that remains to be seen. In fact, I was involved with drafting all these three bills. So I have seen it very closely. But I always remain a little skeptical until I see the implementation, you know, of, you know, exactly how do we implement it on the ground. So I think that's something. But, you know, doctors is only one part of it. As I said, we need nursing, we need dentistry, we need reforms in allied health professionals, your physiotherapists, your optometrists, your nutritionists, you know. So that's something that we really need to do. And as I said, you know, infrastructure, it's fine to build more hospitals. Yes, we need more hospitals. But we need more of the primary, you know, healthcare and more of the prevention and the screening. The cancer is going up in a big way in our country. You know, cancer in younger people. You know, and because we have a very young population. You know, so while in Europe somebody might get cancer at 60, 70, 80, in India you have 30, 35-year-old women. You know, with breast cancer. So we need to really start screening people very young. And we need to focus on early detection. And that will only be possible if we have a strong public health order. Because your doctors cannot go door to door and screen people. That's neither required and neither is it feasible. So you need to have these public health people doing that. And then we have to make people aware. I think that is something that I keep emphasizing, that we need to make more people aware. We need to keep educating people around us that, look, health is not just about being ill, you know, and then you go to a doctor. Health is about staying healthy and well, you know, and make sure that you keep going for your screenings. I think I say this to women all the time. You know, a lot of times as women, we are so busy looking after everybody around us, or we are so busy with our careers or whatever we are doing that we actually forget that, you know, we have to go for this breast screening or we have to go for cervical cancer screening. So, you know, we need to keep educating people around us, and it will start from us and our families and, you know, build out broader into society. But let's keep asking people these questions. Let's ask our friends, let's ask our family people that, hey, you know, have you had your screening this year? Have you had your checkup this year? It's really important, you know, it's really, really important because we need to shift the mindset. We need to shift the mindset from hospital-based curative healthcare to preventive public healthcare. So I think that is really the major direction we need to take from our health system perspective.
The next question we have is from Dhruva Nandi. What strategies should we incorporate to establish and strengthen the public health in rural section of India, which is in operation in a dilute manner?
Yeah, so rural, of course, all of these things do apply to rural as well. But as I said that, you know, the additional sort of things we need to focus on, we have been working on the health and wellness centers, which are supposed to provide primary health care. So we need to really scale up these centers in the rural and remote areas as well. Getting health personnel in rural areas is often very difficult, you know, because you can sometimes pay lakhs and lakhs to people, but nobody wants to go and serve in a rural area. And that is why I strongly believe that we need to train people from the local communities themselves, because it's not really practical to tell somebody who's used to living in a Delhi or a Bombay that, you know, why don't you go and live in a very remote, you know, tribal area, right? It's not very practical. So we need to train people from the local areas because they are the most likely to stay in those areas. So that is something that I think is important in rural. The access issue becomes more important in rural as well, because you know access is difficult. People often have to travel long distances. So we need to ensure that we can provide healthcare close to people. And Ayushman Bharat is, of course, trying to do part of that, including through the health insurance scheme and all. But as I said, you know, insurance will only be as good as your supply. Your health supply has to be good. Your personnel have to be trained. Only then, you know, is your insurance scheme going to be useful. So I think we need to focus on those things of, you know, training personnel as well as, you know, providing health facilities closer to people. I still see people coming from a Jharkhand or, you know, coming from Odisha to Delhi, right, for treatment. I mean, why should people have to come such long distances? We should be able to provide services to people closer to where they are. So I think that's the big priority for rural and remote areas.
Because of the usage of masks, plastic use has risen. So what alternative or strategies can the government consider apart from masks?
What is the question? Sorry, can you repeat the question?
The question is, because of the usage of masks, the use of plastic has risen during the pandemic, and PPE kits also. So what alternatives or strategies can the government consider apart from masks?
The masks actually, and this is something that messaging has been going out, that you know, you don't always have to wear the surgical masks. It's actually not required for something like COVID. For pollution, for air pollution, yes, you need your N95 with a filter actually, but not for COVID. You know, for COVID, you know, even a fairly simple face cover, it doesn't have to be a mask, could be fine, but you do need a face cover. There is really no alternative to that. World over, everyone is having to wear those face covers. So that we do need, but yes, we need to address this whole waste issue, you know, because now we're having people just throwing their masks, you know, into water bodies and, you know, here and there. So, so masks, I can understand the waste management issue, but we do need masks. We do need to wear face covers or masks of some type. I think PPE, you know, right now it's very essential. You know, we can do the segregation, the waste management properly. And in fact, there are some cities in India which have done very good medical waste management at this time. They've come up with good practices. So there is all of that that we need to focus on. But there aren't too many substitutes at this point, you know, because we are in a very sort of crisis situation. So our health workers do need that sort of protection and that level of protection. But yes, for a general population, you know, you could even wear your cloth masks or other things. But even if you're wearing the normal mask, surgical mask, you should, yes, ideally think about how you are disposing them and how the waste management is happening. So that aspect is definitely important.
The next question we have is from Amisha Buthiraja. Preventive healthcare needs to be substantiated with cost effectiveness. Public healthcare is not easy to avail, and promote healthcare is too costly to opt for. So ma'am, what would your stance be on this?
So public health is one of the most substantiated interventions. Public health has a whole body of evidence, you know, if you will just go and look for it. Public health interventions have some of the highest return on investment, whether it is supplementation, whether it is deworming, whether it is fortification, any of the public health interventions, vaccination, these have a huge return on investment, you know. So what you invest, you get back several multiples in economic terms and social terms. And a lot of people have actually quantified these benefits. So you'll see a lot of studies available. So actually public health has some of the most evidence-based interventions that you will find. So that is precisely why you need to invest in public health, because then you will have to invest less in your more costly interventions down the line. So what happens is, if you can prevent a disease or you can detect it early, it is much cheaper, right? Giving an immunization to someone is much cheaper than treating them for cancer at stage 4, right? So that is the difference. That is the difference. I would rather give a human papilloma virus vaccine to a woman than have to treat a woman who has stage 4 cervical cancer. That will be much more expensive. It will be much more difficult. She will have much lower survival chances. Right. So the as they say, prevention is better than cure. that is really what public health is all about. It's about preventing, it's about early detection, and it's actually preventing your health system costs from escalating. I think the best example in the world of this is the United States. The United States has almost no investment in public health or in primary health. They are a very hospital-focused, private insurance-based system. And if you see, their costs are escalating all the time. All the time, their costs are going through the roof. They are investing 17-18% of their GDP in healthcare, but their outcomes are much poorer compared to the rest of the OECD countries. So the US is exactly an example of why we need to invest in public health and preventive health so that we can get better outcomes for the population at a cheaper price. Otherwise, you could be spending your entire GDP on healthcare and you will still not get the kind of outcomes that you need to have. So that is really the way forward for us, and that is the way to prevent cost escalation and for costing, you know, to become higher. Because as your interventions get more advanced in health, your costs also go up.
Ma'am, the next question is, what would be your opinion on herd immunity?
Okay, yeah, I mean, you know, herd immunity is not a strategy for a disease. Because herd immunity as a strategy for a disease is like saying that I'm okay with killing X number of people, you know, because I want to achieve herd immunity. So it's not a strategy. Herd immunity is something that can end up happening. If you just let the epidemic play out in the population, you don't do any interventions. Yes, after a while, you will get herd immunity, but you will also lose lives in the process. So it cannot be a strategy. It's not a strategy. Herd immunity is used in public health in a protective context. So you normally use herd immunity in public health with a vaccine. That if I can vaccinate 60-70% of the population, I will achieve herd immunity. Right? That is the context in which you use herd immunity. You cannot use herd immunity to say that it's my strategy for the epidemic, you know, because that means that I am actually sitting here and saying I'm okay with X number of people dying. And obviously, you know, as a system, you can never be okay, right, with even one person losing their lives. So it's not a strategy. It should only be used. It should only be used in the context of a protective vaccine. That is the only context in which you should ever use herd immunity. If it's a protective intervention, that if I give you the vaccine, you will actually, you know, have a protective effect on those around you. Over a period of time, that is the context in which you should use it, but never in the context of a disease.
One last question we'll take, and that is, how, in what ways has the pandemic disproportionately affected women?
Yeah, many different dimensions to this. One is healthcare itself. As I said, that, you know, a lot of essential health services have suffered. So we have a lot of pregnant women who have missed their antenatal checkups. We have, of course, then, you know, children, of course, after they've been born, they've missed vaccinations. So, of course, maternal and child health in particular as an area is affected. The other thing that women have also suffered with is a fair amount of increase in domestic violence. And while we, you know, might not have a lot of official statistics in this, often when it comes to women, we don't have very good official statistics. But there has been an increase for sure. During the lockdown period, even otherwise, women have borne the brunt of increase in domestic violence. This is not just true in India, by the way, this is true globally. This is true world over. And the third piece is that for a lot of women, this work from home has actually become, you know, more of a problem because they are working from home and doing all the housework. So it's become like double the work, you know, in some senses for a lot of women, because, you know, you've not had other sort of house help or whatever you might usually have. So for a lot of women, they have actually had to manage too many things simultaneously at this time. So it's actually affected them adversely, even from a mental health perspective. It has taken a toll. Of course, mental health, you know, affects all of us. It's affecting men and women. But there has been that little bit of a disproportionate impact on women with that as well. And as I said, a lot of other, you know, relatively marginalized communities traditionally, like people with disabilities. You know, I know of a lot of such people who have struggled, you know, during the lockdown period, and otherwise there are transgender persons who've had difficulties. So yes, it's not just women, it's a lot of other groups which have the senior citizens. I think senior citizens is another group, especially during lockdown. You know, they suffered due to services and also just the loneliness and the anxiety and, you know, all the mental health issues also. So I think there has been this sort of disproportionate impact on certain groups. And I think, you know, we really need to now focus on ensuring that this is, we have a way of reversing some of it. We cannot reverse all of it, unfortunately, but at least whatever we can reverse going forward by focusing on these groups in particular, whether it's in partnership with NGOs, whether it's in partnership with voluntary organizations, because it's true that the government can't be everywhere. You know, that's true. I mean, it is true that any government cannot be everywhere. So we do need to partner with all these different types of organizations, but a strong focus on these groups who have been left behind a little bit in this process has to be brought in.
The next question we have is from Natasha Singh. There has been gray area in the reporting of current status of our public health system. Some states say that it is collapsing with the arrival of the second/third wave. However, some states say that they're ready for the absolute extremes. What, according to you, is the present state of our public health system?
Yeah, I mean, it is variable. You know, yes, it is variable. Some states, as I said, they inherently have a stronger public health system. Some have had inherently a weaker system. So yes, our disparities always exist in the system. They just become exacerbated at a time like this. They just become exaggerated at a time like this. But I will say that this is a disease which has overwhelmed even some of the best public health systems in the world. Sweden is a very classic example. Sweden actually did not go in for a lockdown. They thought they can manage. They have a good public health system. They have very knowledgeable, aware people. But Sweden has really fared badly on COVID compared to its neighbors, compared to Finland, Denmark, you know, all those countries, Norway. And their economy has also suffered. So Sweden has actually ended up suffering on both counts, you know, lives and livelihoods. And it's one of the most advanced public health systems, you know. So I think in a time like this, you know, and now if you see the state of Kerala, I think Kerala has one of our best public health systems. But Kerala has been really dealing with the second wave and third wave, and it's been very difficult for Kerala, you know, because they had Onam. They had a lot of international people coming back into the state, coming back from these different international, you know, destinations. And so Kerala now has seen a real spike, you know, and they are sort of struggling to keep, you know, up to terms with this. So I think that something like this can actually overwhelm any system at any point in time. And I think that is the message from COVID, that you can never be complacent. You can never think that, oh, you know, I've got this, you know, there's no issue, because very quickly it can overwhelm you. So I think we need to have, you know, all that sticking to our basics very much in place. And as I said, the next few weeks and months are very crucial for India, you know, because we are in this very tricky phase. We certainly need to control the cases, because before we know, you know, we can also have a big escalation like Europe or US, and that will not be desirable. I don't think anywhere in the country we have a system that will be able to cope with that. So I think people also need to play a big partnership in this and you know, try and make sure that in the festive season and other things, we do sort of keep some sort of check on our activities and our gatherings. Yes, everybody has had a very long, draining time, and it's not easy. But, you know, we just have to do that, because otherwise, if we have a huge surge, I think most places in the country would actually struggle with that. So yes, we will need both the health system as well as people to really be working together at this point in time.
Right. The next question is, do you think an extremely stringent and powerful healthcare strategy to control COVID, or a slightly scaled down, realistic, sustainable healthcare diplomacy suits better for India?
I'm not sure I get the question. Could you just repeat it?
The way I understand it, I think it's whether we need to have a more stringent approach towards the kind of strategies that we impose on the general population in terms of COVID. Is that better for India, or a slightly more realistic? Right.
Yeah, you know, India, we don't have much of a choice because of our structure. We are a federal structure. We are, you know, we are a federal a democracy. You know, if you look at some of the unitary forms of government, like Vietnam, Vietnam's done very well on COVID management, but they brought in the military everywhere. You know, they literally brought in the military everywhere. Now, if India was to bring in its military everywhere, it would become very, very difficult, you know. So, you know, we have a different form of government. We don't have a unitary form of government. It's not, you know, just sitting at the center and trying to control everything. That's not how India is structured, at least. And that's obviously not how we can be functioning. So I think, yes, you do pay a price. I think you do pay a price in a pandemic, because, you know, if everything is very command and control, and imagine you have the military forcing everybody inside their houses, that's probably going to be much more efficient. But in India, that's not really the option for us. So therefore, we are trying to, you know, go with a more collaborative approach with people, trying to encourage people, urge people to, you know, follow some of these rather than use force. Yes, in some cases, people have used the police, you know, to enforce local lockdowns and, you know, to do door-to-door contact tracing. So yes, of course, your police can still be used strategically in some cases. But it has to be, there's a fine balance in India, you know, there's a fine balance between using the police and then somebody saying, oh my God, you know, why are you beating me up for this? So in India, we always have to be very, very sort of treading that fine, fine balance. And yes, I think there are advantages and disadvantages to that in a pandemic situation. You know, Vietnam would probably say our model is very successful. You know, we've done very well, and you can't deny that, right? On COVID metrics, they've done phenomenally well. But their means were quite different from what we in India are used to, right? So it's a bit of a difficult one here. But we don't have a choice here because of the kind of structure we are. We have to work within this system, and we have to try and find the best way within this imperfect, you know, system that we have.
Question today would be, this pandemic has completely changed a lot of important aspects of our life, including our access to education. The education sector has taken a big hit, with a large chunk of the population struggling to adapt to the new normal. What reforms would you suggest in the education sector to prepare in case a similar situation arises in the future?
Yeah, I mean, this is, you know, I think this is a tricky one. Because I have a lot of issues with this whole online education and these whole digital, everything being digital. I mean, I struggle myself, you know. I can't be sitting in front of these webinars all the time. I find it so taxing. So I can only imagine, right? You're expecting children, you're expecting everybody to study like that. It's not natural. It doesn't come naturally to us. So yes, you know, given that we were faced with the situation, you know, we just had to come up with whatever solutions we could. But we have to recognize the limitations of those solutions. And we have to recognize that technology is not, as I said, the holy grail. You know, technology is very useful. It has many uses, but it's not the sort of magic bullet solution to everything. So we'll have to develop some other types of solutions as well. I think post this, and I think now that educators have also, you know, had more time to think through this, I'm sure that they will also come up with some, you know, because also access with technology is a big issue. You know, I can be sitting, and if I have good internet in my house, I can be doing all this online stuff. But what about someone who doesn't have the internet, right? And there are still enough people. There are enough people who will not have access to good quality internet and all of this. So somewhere those people get left out as well. So yes, of course, we need to expand the reach of digital itself. But we also need to think of these non-digital solutions, whatever they might be. You know, I don't think everything can just be digital. I don't think everything can just move online. So how do we come up with that is something that, you know, I think with educators, you know, work with them and think of those solutions. It will take time, I think, to develop those solutions. It needs a wide range of sort of consultation amongst the practitioners with, you know, at all levels, right? Because even in education, you're talking right from the youngest child, you are educating right up to higher education. So there's a huge sort of range, right? Even within education, you will have to come up with different solutions depending on the age that you're tackling, the class you're tackling, and all those kinds of things. So I think that is something we will see in the days to come. We will see some more of these sort of possible solutions coming out. But I would just say that I just hope everything is not just digital. You know, I think that's just the easiest way to think of something. But it has huge limitations. And I just hope that we would appreciate these limitations as well.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your time. With this, we've come to the end of the third colloquium.
I think there is somebody asking a question on mental health again and again. So I just want to answer that before I go, because I think the person is very keen to have that question answered.
Oh, I must have completely missed it. Right. The question is,
yeah,
it's disturbing to see how neglected the whole question of mental health is in our country. It took the pandemic to start talking about it. But why is there no policy turned towards this pertinent issue?
So, you know, there is a policy. There is, in fact, even an act. We have a Mental Health Care Act as well. But, you know, mental health, again, is a very complex issue because it's an intersection of your health challenges and your social challenges. So it's not just a health issue, but it's also a social issue. In our country, we stigmatize a lot of conditions. We stigmatize a lot of things in our country. You know, we stigmatize health issues. It's not just COVID stigma. You know, TB is stigmatized. I have met young people in TB patients in slums, slum areas, and you know, they will say to me that I don't want to tell anyone I have TB. I'd rather die, but I will not tell anyone I have TB. And I used to say, you know, why? TB is perfectly curable. You know, why would you say that? Young people, you know. So that is because we as society also, we have a habit of, you know, stigmatizing. We judge people a lot. I think we also need to be less judgmental of everybody and their choices and what they do and what they don't do and what disease they have and what disease they don't have. I think that is also a big intersection. It's not just a health issue, but it's also a societal issue, you know. If I look at women, you know, in fact, you might be surprised to know that India has the highest number of suicides in the young demographic, in the young age group. And 70% of those suicides are women. You know, 70% of those suicides are women. We often talk of farmer suicides, but nobody talks of women suicides, you know. And those are huge numbers. And these are young women. These are young women, you know, in their 20s, in their early 30s. So it's a huge problem. It's a huge societal and health issue. And we need to talk more about it. We need to break the stigma. We need to, of course, increase access to services, mental health services. We have hardly any psychologists, psychiatrists. As I said, you know, we need to increase all of these. But we also need to increase the more downstream health personnel, you know, because for everything, you can't have a psychiatrist. You know, you can even have lesser qualified people, but they can provide some counseling, some support to people, at least at an early stage. So we need to build out all of that. But I think the most important in mental health is to talk about it, to remove the stigma, to make it like any other disease, right? If I have a fever, I'm not ashamed to tell anybody. So if I have anxiety or if I have schizophrenia, bipolar, whatever, equally, I should not feel ashamed. And I should not feel judged. I think if we can remove this judgment that we place on everything, then I think it will really help. Because, you know, I think we judge too much. We judge way too much, you know, people for their choices and what they wish to do and, you know, all of that. So I think if that we address, we will take some steps forward in this. But it's a huge area. I completely agree that it's a huge area and a hugely neglected area hitherto. And I hope that now, you know, we will really focus on it. And I think one good thing the pandemic has done is talking about mental health has become quite common now. You know, I find people even on Twitter saying that, oh, I'm feeling anxious or I'm feeling, and that's actually very good, you know, because we need to have that conversation openly because we all feel anxious. We all have these issues, you know, it's not something which is so peculiar. So we need to talk about it very, very freely.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. I think with this, we come to an end. I'm sorry for overlooking the last question. It completely missed me. But thank you so much for attending. I think this was a greatly insightful session. And Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I hope it was useful, and I'd be happy to do other such sessions as well. I mean, I just said I don't like this online medium, but we don't have a choice right now. So, you know, whatever way we can interact, I would be happy to do that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye-bye.